If any man speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man ministers, let him minister as the strength that God supplies, that in all things God's name will be glorified through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Highly esteemed listeners, welcome to the Oracles of God radio broadcast, a biblical program that is run and sponsored by the Churches of Christ, which come your way every Wednesday on Radio Universe 105.7 FM. Shall we go to God in prayer? Oh, blessed everlasting Father, maker of heavens and earth, who was, who is to come, the Lord God Almighty, we bless your name this morning as we see your glory, honor, and blessings on our lives. When we are able to hear this message, and even as we are able to come to you in prayer, it's a testimony that you've added us to the living, not because of our righteousness, but because of abundance, grace, and mercy beyond measure. Thank you once again for ushering us into this brand new Wednesday. We pray you forgive us all our sins we've committed against you, in thoughts, in actions, and in speech. Bless us, O Lord, as we continue to listen to your oracles, that let your words come unto us and heal it, that our hearts may be open and be able to understand, that we may be able to be built up in you in this world and the world to come. We are asking for your strength, that we'll be able to do exactly what's expected of us. Once again, we thank you for the lives of the staff of Radio Universe, that continue to grant them your strength and wisdom, that they may be able to transmit these oracles unadulterated to your audience. Begin and end successfully with us, in the name above all names, Jesus Christ, our Lord, do we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Distinguished listeners, we are still on a series of lessons we draw from the theme, Dead Preachers Pray to Us, or Let the Dead Prophet Speak to Us. And we have discussed Jonah, Prophet Jonah, and Amos. Wonderful lessons have been drawn, and in all these we see a similarity of their main purpose of the prophets being to communicate to God's people his instructions. Even at the time that they were prophesying, as a minute aspect of their vocation, in prophesying about the Messiah that was recorded, even when you read through even their prophecy, you still see strong warnings, strong teachings from the Lord, asking God's people to depart from iniquity and come to him. And so you realize that there is a clear difference between the prophets of God in the Old Testament that people claim today they are, and what people do today. Today we'll move on to another prophet, so that we'll draw lessons as we've done for the first two. And the prophet we're going to discuss this morning is Hosea. Hosea, distinguished listeners, little is known of Hosea's early years. He was a prophet to the northern kingdom of Israel during times of great international turmoil. He was born in the north, and his ministry began during the reign of Jeroboam II of the northern kingdom, that between 770 to 749 BC. It extended into the reign of Hezekiah, or the southern kingdom of Israel, that is 728 to 697 BC. His ministry could have extended throughout the latter part of the reign of Jeroboam II, thus making his ministry one of the longest of the prophets. This made Hosea contemporary with both Isaiah and Micah, who prophesied to the southern kingdom. Hosea's name means salvation, the same meaning as the names Joshua and Jesus. Since the ministry of Hosea extended through the fall of the northern kingdom, we assume that his name is also prophetic of the salvation of the remnant that will come almost 200 years later with the return of the first Jewish captives in 536 BC. Distinguished listeners, Hosea is considered the Apostle John to the northern kingdom, which was destined for captivity. In order that he understand how God felt that his life was betrayed when the people went after Baal, God commanded Hosea to marry Gomer. After the marriage, Gomer forsook Hosea and gave herself over to prostitution. Regardless of her unfaithfulness, Hosea, upon God's command, was willing to take her back as his wife in order to rebuild his marriage. Though Gomer had broken his heart, Hosea, as God, was willing to take again his bride because of his devotion to her. Likewise, the remnant of Israel will be taken from captivity by God in order to be his bride once again. Distinguished listeners, Hosea fathered three children with Gomer, according to Hosea chapter 1, verses 3 through 9. The first was named Jezreel, meaning vengeance. The name was prophetic in that God would bring judgment upon the house of the wicked king Jehu. The second child was named Lo-Ruhama, meaning no pity. This name was also prophetic in that God will have no mercy on the existing Israelites who had forsaken him for idol gods they had created after their own worldly desires. The third child was named Lo-Ami, meaning not my people. This name was prophetic in that Israel had backslidden so far away from God that he could not claim them as his people. Distinguished listeners, because the northern kingdom called Ephraim after the largest tribe played the harlot, God cast her away into Assyrian captivity. The key word of this book, therefore, is judgment. Ephraim was doomed to termination. It will be as Amos prophesied in Amos chapter 5, verse 2. Amos 5, 2, it reads, "The virgin of Israel has fallen. She will rise no more." Unquote. It will be a tragic end to a beautiful story of a nation that has a special covenant relationship with the creator of the universe. Israel will cease to exist as an independent theocratic nation of God in Palestine. Those who assume that the present state of Israel in Palestine is a God-ordained state need to take another look at the prophecy of Amos chapter 5 verse 2. An independent state of Israel does exist in Palestine, but it is not a nation state with which God had a special covenant relationship. The covenanted nation of Israel no longer exists. The possession of Palestine by the theocratic nation of Israel ended with Assyrian and Babylonian captivities. This is what Amos was prophesying. The remnant of Israel that returned after the Babylonian captivity remained under the Sinai covenant and law until the coming of the Messiah. But the covenant ended in Christ as prophesied by Jeremiah. In Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 31 to 33, Jeremiah 31, 31 to 33, that Apostle Paul quoted in Hebrews chapter 8, verse 7 to 13, Hebrews 8, 7 to 13, and also Hebrews chapter 9, verse 15. The same senseless. And when the covenant ended, then the nation ceased to exist as a special people in the eyes of God. Distinguished listeners, let's look at the historical and social background that led Hosea to the very work that he did. Because of the length of Hosea's ministry, he lived through the final years of the fall of the northern 10 tribes of Israel and the beginning of the fall of the southern 2 tribes. There was chaos in the leadership among the kings of the north prior to their fall. In in a few years before he began to preach the end of Ephraim, Jehu had killed King Joram. In 2 Kings chapter 9, verse 21 to 28, Jehu also slaughtered the heads of the wicked Jezebel and Ahab. Then came Jehoahaz and Joash. King Jeroboam II finally brought some stability during his 41-year reign. It was sometime during the reign of Jeroboam that Hosea and Amos began together to preach the end of Israel. The people eventually ran the former preacher, Amos, back to Judah. But the local preacher, Hosea, continued to be God's representative in the north until the, and after the end of the northern kingdom. It was after the death of Jeroboam that the northern kingdom fell into a state of chaos among its leaders. After Jeroboam, Zechariah reigned only 6 months before he was murdered by Shallum. That's 2 Kings chapter 15, verse 8 to 12. Shallum also reigned only 1 month before Menahem deposed him. 2 Kings chapter 15, verse 13 to 16. Menahem fortunately died a natural death, but only after 10 years on the throne. 2 Kings 15, 17 to 22. However, distinguished listeners, during his reign, the Assyrian king Tiglath-Pileser invaded Israel. After Menahem came Pekahiah, who reigned only 2 years before he was murdered by Pekah. You identify, you realize that when you have no God, there is chaos. A nation without God, there is chaos. And so you see the turmoil in Israel history as we are recording this day. And that is exactly what a nation like Ghana should learn about. Every nation under the sun should learn to let God be their helper, their guidance, and their leader. Even though we are seeing human beings as on the helm of affairs in nations, it is God who reigns through them. It's important that these leaders allow God to really use them. Now, within a short span in the history of Israel, look at the swiftness with which they changed their governments. Pekah recruited help from the Egyptians to defend Israel against the Assyrians. He then made an alliance with Rezin of Syria in order to overthrow Ahaz of the southern kingdom, Judah. But Pekah was eventually murdered by King Hosea, who in turn paid tribute to the Assyrians in order that he might continue his reign. Then again, Shalmaneser V, the king of Assyria, eventually arrested King Hosea. King Hosea was thinking that because he was affiliating himself in an alliance with the king of Assyria, then he had protection. He didn't know that was God who was reigning and is reigning. And therefore, the very person he ran to for protection also arrested him, which began the fall of the northern kingdom. The civil listeners, the successor to King Shalmaneser, Sargon, conquered the capital of the northern kingdom in 722 to 21 BC, Samaria, and thus ended the existence of the 10 tribes as an independent nation of God in the land of Palestine. The nation was God for good forever, as an independent nation, having given up their right to exist as a God-covenanted nation because they had forsaken the word of God. Nevertheless, God promised that only a remnant of the southern 2 tribes with a remnant of the 10 tribes from the north would eventually be restored to Palestine. The remnant will return to the land in order to re-establish the identity of Israel. However, they will return to a land that no longer belonged to them. It will belong to the Medo-Persian Empire. The same is listeners. Hosea was a preacher for God during these years of international turmoil and moral decline. It was an era of history in which it was not easy to be a spokesman for God. It was a time of social chaos and religious confusion simply because the Israelites had long ignored the word of God. In doing so, they as a whole ceased being the moral people of God. It was only when God rescued the remnant of Israel out of captivity that they were able to bring the Messiah into the world in fulfillment of the promises that were made to the fathers of Israel. And so the first chaos that we need to talk about is social chaos during this period. Social chaos. Distinguished listeners, instead of trusting in God for help, as they promised when they accepted the Sinai covenant at the beginning, Israel began to trust in their own strength and the strength of other nations. They thus forsook loyalty to God. They were guilty of divine treason. They did not trust that God would deliver them from all the enemies. Justice was perverted because bribery became the accepted means by which favors could be extracted from officials. According to Amos chapter 5, verse 12. Amos 5, 12. The prophet Micah explained the social conditions of the nations in Micah 3, 11. Micah 3, 11, when he said, her heads judge for a bribe, and her priests teach for hire, and her prophets divine for money. The same as the listeners. Is that not what we see today? When the heads will judge for a bribe, and the priests will teach for a hire, consultation fees, consultation for consultation fees, doing everything for a hire, whether even if it is so correct. Is that not the same thing we are experiencing today? And that is the reason why we need to let the dead prophet speak to us, so that we'll be vigilant and understand what is happening, and rely on this Jesus Christ, the only Son of God that will be given for man to be saved. And he continued, and the prophets divine for money. Micah 3:11. Reread that portion and you will see similarity to what we have today. The same as listeners. Micah added in Micah chapter 7 verse 3. Micah 7:3, he said, the prince and the judge ask for a bribe, and the great one utters his mischievous desire. Unquote. The serious listeners, they have certainly forgotten the law of the covenant that they accepted at Mount Sinai. For one of the laws of the covenant was in Exodus chapter 23, verse 8. Exodus 23, 8 reads, and you will take no bribe. God told the people in the covenant he made with them in Exodus chapter 23, verse 8, and you will take no bribe, for the bribe blinds the wise and perverts the words of the righteous. I want to read that again. Exodus chapter 23, verse 8. And you will take no bribe. This is God speaking to his people. And you will take no bribe, for the bribe blinds the wise and perverts the words of the righteous. Unquote. Distinguished listeners, when the culture of government falls into the evil of bribery, it has judged itself dysfunctional as a government of justice for the people. No fair judgment can be given in a culture of bribery. A culture of bribery always marginalizes the poor, for the poor do not have the means by which to bribe officials in their favor. A superficial democracy with a culture of bribery can exist only insofar as those in power can deceive the poor majority that the officials are for them. In a culture of bribery, the officials of the government are themselves at heart, and thus use the people as the occasion to satisfy their lust for power and greed for gain. When a society curses itself with a culture of bribery, it has fallen out of favor with God. The same as listeners, bribery is paying someone in order to have a favor done for the one who gives the bribe. Corruption is paying someone in view of the fact that the favor has been done. These two moral flaws make a society morally dysfunctional. Both practices handicap individuals within a society, particularly the poor. Corruption is bribery that is masked in the guise of the misappropriation of public funds for selfish use. The greater the corruption of a nation, the more government of the nation is out of favor with God the Almighty. For it is a nation whose government is controlled by the lack of money, the shamelessness. It is a nation whose government has forgotten its responsibility to make sure that the people as a society take care of the poor. And any government that does not lead the nation as a whole to take care of the poor is an unrighteous government in the eyes of God. That is lesson number one. Social chaos. That is a signal of a fall away from the God Almighty. And the rulers in the nation are no longer in favor of God. The second lesson is religious corruption. Apart from the social chaos, we are also learning from Hosea, religious corruption. Religious corruptions, the shamelessness. Since Hosea began his prophetic ministry in times of national prosperity, everything in the function of the society was based on the exchange of money. Both civic officials and religious leaders did their work on the basis of extracting money from someone. They all ran greedily after the example of Balaam, who sold his prophetic gift for money. When money becomes the moral standard by which a society functions, then the society becomes corrupt. Volunteerism and charity are very low in those societies where money is the moral standard by which the individuals of a society relate to one another. Or the priests go judged and as gangs of raiders wait for a man. I want to read that again. Hosea chapter 6 verse 9. Hosea 6:9, it reads, and as gangs of raiders wait for a man, so the company of priests murder in the way by consent, for they commit lewdness. Unquote. The shamelessness. The religious culture of the Canaanites was well entrenched in the behavior of Israel by the time of Hosea's ministry. The sensual cult worship of the Canaanites became the religion of the people. The fertility gods of Baal worship were initially instituted in the northern kingdom by Jeroboam I when the 10 tribes separated from the south after the death of Solomon. Since the deities of the Canaanites were symbolized by the bull, Jeroboam I set up a bull altar in Dan and another in Bethel. 1 Kings chapter 12, verse 28 to 29. 1 Kings 12, 28 to 29. Canaanite religion included occult rites of drunken parties, prostitution, and wanton behavior by those who participated in all sorts of sexual sin. Even a century after the ministry of Hosea, prostitution and sodomy became associated with the temple in Jerusalem during the days of Hezekiah. In 2 Kings chapter 23, verse 7. 2 Kings 23, 7. Hosea's indictment of Israel was the description of a totally depraved social and religious culture. Because he said, in Hosea chapter 10, verse 13, Hosea 10, 13, he said, you have plowed wickedness, you have reaped iniquity, you have eaten the fruit of lies, because you trust in your way, in the multitude of your mighty men. Unquote. The same business. Let us therefore look what does Hosea preach to us. What is Hosea telling us this morning? Hosea preaches to us. The same business. All the social and moral degradation that existed during the days of Hosea was because the people were determined to live contrary to all that God would have them be. And so Hosea chapter 11 verse 7, Hosea 11 verse 7, it reads, and my people are bent on backsliding from me, unquote. When that which is considered to be right by a society is actually contrary to the word of God, then the society has judged itself evil in the sight of God. So the lesson that we are drawing as Hosea preaches to us today is that we strive for lack of knowledge of the word of God. they strive for lack of knowledge of the word of God. All the social and religious calamity of Ephraim was the result of one thing. And what was one thing? God pointed out that thing in Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. Hosea 4, he said, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because you have rejected knowledge, that is of my law, I will also reject you so that you be no priest to me. See, you have forgotten the law of your God. I will also forget your children." Unquote. Their lack of knowledge of God through his word had gone to the extreme of rejection. They considered the message of Hosea and the other prophets as strange teaching. In Hosea chapter 8, verse 12, Hosea 8, 12, he said, "I have written to him the great things of my law, but they were counted as a foreign thing." Is that not sad? The real truth of God rather was considered a strange thing. Today, lies are so abundant by people who claim to be men and women of God that it is all over the place, that when even you are holding the true message, it is so strange to them. It is strange to people. They find out whether this is even in the Bible, because they find it as foreign and strange. Why? Because there are abundance of lies. People no longer feel shy to ask for money or hiring to preach the word of God. People no longer feel shy. On the screens of our televisions, they are there asking people to pay consultation fee, even online, even by air, even by whatever. At first, it was a hidden thing. Now it has become so rampant in such a way that they no longer feel shy. And that is exactly what it is. When you are deep in sin and you continue rejecting God's word, it reaches a point that sin is no longer sin to you. It is so common and ordinary to you. And people are not afraid of this Almighty God, of all these lessons. And they stand boldly asking people to pay consultation fee and preaching for a hire. Meanwhile, even the message of preaching are full of lies. And so when you send the truth to people, they find it strange. Yes, that was exactly what was happening during Hosea's day. And God had to speak in Hosea chapter 8, verse 12. Hosea 8, he said, "I've written to him the great things of my law, but they were counted as a foreign thing." It was evident in civil business that the priests among the people had certainly failed in their duty to teach the people the law of God. When those whom we presume should know their Bibles stand before the people but know nothing of the Bible, then we allow ourselves to be led astray into apostasy. And such we see prevalent throughout the religious world today. Pastors and priests around the world know little of the Bible. They are presumptuous to stand before the people and profess to be leaders of the people for God. They are as blind guides leading the blind into destruction. It is as Jesus said in Matthew chapter 15, verse 14. Matthew 15, 14. "They are blind leaders of the blind. And if the blind lead the blind, both will fall into the ditch." The civil listeners. God is so wonderful, and he continues to remind us of his laws. And it's very important that we appreciate the wonderful book that he left with us. There are so many examples and warnings in them that will teach us how to relate to him and flee from charlatans, people who are more than wolves, and they will devour us. The religious environment of Christendom today is not unlike the religious environment of Hosea's day, when the people were destroyed for lack of knowledge. It was not that they became unbelievers. No. On the contrary, they remained religious. In the absence of a knowledge of the law of God, however, they simply created a religion after their own desires that was void of the word of God. For example, when they became covetous of the things of the world, then they created a religion that soothed their guilt about being greedy. They thus felt guiltless when they exploited the poor for the sake of the own lust. This is idolatry. Again, it is as Paul wrote that we put to death our members that are on the earth. In Colossians chapter 3 verse 5. Colossians 3 5 he says, we should put to death our members that are on the earth. Covetousness, which is idolatry. This is restlessness. This is where time will permit today. God willing, we shall continue with Hosea with other lessons. Have you now realized how important for us to share these lessons? They are very similar to our environment today. And just as God warned the people to desist from certain acts and bless those who were obedient, so it is today. And so we need to draw lessons from these prophets and be wary of people that may deceive us into hell. God loves us and he has prepared wonderful places for us. And he's saying that he has given us a mentality that is capable of distinguishing between truth and lies. And as whether we are presidents, whether we are ministers, whether we are parliamentarians, whether we are in high positions, whether we are poor or rich, this goes for us. It's important for us to know that without God we are absolutely nothing. And just as these people fell into social and religious chaos, so shall we if we don't desist from very things that is warning against. God willing, we shall continue with lessons that Hosea will teach us as we've learned some today. Once again, this has been the Oracles of God radio broadcast, a biblical program that is run and sponsored by the Churches of Christ, which comes your way every Wednesday, 5:30 a.m. Make a day with us. Same time, God willing, next week, as God continues to unravel his priceless oracles, you warmly invited to worship with Churches of Christ all over the country, the pillar of truth, where an unadulterated word of God is shared and God is worshipped in spirit and in truth. You may want to contact us on 024-552-7658 or send us a message on coc.radio@yahoo.com. We are also located on Facebook at Church Radio. Church Radio on Facebook. I am once again your brother Eric Naako. Now may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify us through and through. May our whole body, soul, and spirit become blameless and the appearance of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Till we meet again, stay richly blessed. Amen and good morning.